Hello! My name is Julia Catherine Walsh, and together with my colleague, Dr. Tsu-Wa Ho, we would like to welcome you today to Women in Music. This is the second part of our Women in Music series, and today we will be dealing with the topic of women as performers. Since we have only an hour, we have chosen five pieces which are representative of some very influential and important international classical women singers who we would like to honor with our performances of these pieces today. Because we can't cover all of the notable singers, we have included their names on the presentation slides so that if you are curious, you can take a look at them yourself. I would like to especially thank for today's performance Dr. Tsu-Wa Ho's incredible effort to record the piano versions of orchestral scores for these five pieces which you will hear. Even though she only has one piano and two hands, I think she's doing an extraordinary job, and I hope you'll pay special attention to hear all of the amazing things that she is doing. Thank you so much for being with us, and we are looking forward to getting started, so let's dive right in. The first singer that we'd like to honor today in our program is Beverly Sills, and we will be singing a piece from The Ballad of Baby Doe, which is by American composer Douglas Moore and was premiered in 1956 at Central City Opera Company in Central City, Colorado. Beverly Sills got to sing this role, however, in 1958, 2 years later, once it had been brought to New York since it was so incredibly successful in Central City. And because the stage directors were looking for a person who physically resembled Baby Doe in stature, and because Beverly Sills was quite tall, they originally didn't consider her for the role, even though, vocally speaking, she was ideally suited for it. Of course, Beverly got wind of this and thought to herself, well, why should I audition for this role if they think I'm too tall? Let them get somebody else. So it goes that they auditioned hundreds of sopranos and never found anybody that they really liked. Then it came, of course, to the time where they had to give Beverly a call and basically beg her to come to audition for the role. She was living in Cleveland at the time, so she put up a little bit of a fight, but finally they talked her into it. And so it was said in her autobiography that she showed up with the highest high heels she could find because she wanted to underline the fact that she wasn't going to change herself in any physical way so that she could play this role, and she still could play it really well. And you know what? She was right. She ended up wowing both the stage director and the composer who was there at her audition, and even the composer afterwards said, Beverly, you were Baby Doe. And so it is that some really important singers come to give meaning to roles that were created for not one person in particular, but then eventually come across them and interpret them in such a way as they become iconic and they become synonymous with this particular singer. And thus is the case with Beverly Sills and Baby Doe, because until this day, even though there have been many other notable interpreters, there still is not one who has sung it as well as Beverly Sills and as truthfully many critics feel in her interpretation. So, if that's gotten you curious, let's hear Ballad of Baby Doe's Willow Song. The next singer we'd like to showcase in today's program is Lily Palms for her interpretation of the role of Lacme, which is from the opera of the same name written by Leo Delibes in Paris, France between 1881 and 1882. At the time, Paris and most of Europe, especially its artistic milieu, was fascinated with the idea of exoticism, and thus a story about a Hindu girl and her life coming into contact with foreigners was very of the moment and became quite popular. So Delibes was an extremely good marketer as well as a good composer. And Lily Pons came to this role in 1928 when she premiered it at a small theater in Alsace, France, and sung it for the following year and a half in theaters in the surrounding area. And at one of those theaters, two of her colleagues who thought she was quite good and were about to embark on a trip to New York City to audition for the Metropolitan Opera suggested that she come along with them to try her hand at auditioning as well. And so she did, and thus it was that in 1931, just when Amélie de Galicourti was about to retire from the Met, and so they were looking for somebody to sing all of these types of roles that Lily Pons would then take over from her, she came there, she auditioned, and she was hired because she did so very well. Her premiere was actually singing Lucia in Lucia di Lammermoor, but Lacme became her most famous signature role, not only because of her petite stature and because of her costume showing her bare belly button, which at the time was quite sensational, but also because her vocalism was incredibly crystalline and beautiful and bell-like and exactly what this role needs. So, hopefully you're now curious to hear my rendition of the bell song along with Tsuwa's incredible playing of this piano part. It is not easy. So, here we have the bell song.
Ooh.
The next piece on our program is Barber's Knoxville Summer of 1915, which is the only piece that does not come from an opera on today's program, but is rather a piece written for a soloist with orchestral accompaniment. And it was written in 1947 and commissioned actually by Eleanor Stieber, who premiered it in 1948 with the Boston Symphony Orchestra and with Sergei Koussevitzky conducting. Unfortunately, it didn't get quite the press coverage that they had hoped for, because in the exact same evening, at the exact same performance, Koussevitzky decided to announce his retirement from conducting. So unfortunately, Knoxville got a little bit of a backseat to the press announcements the following day. However, it has remained a popular piece in the American classical music canon, and it was then also recorded by Leontine Price a little bit later on a CD, and at that time on a record. And it was also made very popular through her interpretation, which was incredibly beautiful. And she, of course, was one of the most frequent collaborators with Samuel Barber and did quite a lot of other things with him, one of which we talked about in Women in Music Part 1, his Hermit Songs. She sung the premiere. And so it was that when she sung Knoxville, she is quoted as saying, "It was like painting a picture of my hometown, and that's the way I sang it," because she grew up in a small town as well in Laurel, Mississippi. And so even reminiscing about Knoxville, Tennessee, from James Agee, who is the writer of the lyrics, was not too far afield for Miss Price or for Miss Stieber, actually, in the idea of a sort of common American history. Okay. Hope you're looking forward to hearing this piece. It's a little bit longer than the other ones, but it is almost like a film. So I invite you to let the language evoke all of these beautiful pictures in your mind and just see where it takes you. Thank you.
Thank you.
This next piece is a piece that is near and dear to my heart, and it's from Mozart's The Magic Flute, and it is the Queen of the Night's second aria called Der Hölle Rache. Mozart wrote The Magic Flute in 1791, and he was very lucky that indeed his sister-in-law, Josefa Hofau, whose maiden name was Weber at the time, was able to premiere this role. And she was singing professionally in Vienna at the opera there. And Mozart was so, so lucky that she was able to sing these notes. And indeed, it was said that because she could sing them so well and had such fluidity and facility with her voice, that he wrote this piece so difficult. So we can thank her, or perhaps we should be awed at her ability based on this being seemingly easy for her. Unfortunately, we don't have recordings of her singing, but drat, I wish we would have, because I bet she was fabulous. However, we do have some recordings of our next interpreter who I'd like to mention, Etta Moza, and indeed, a recording of her singing this piece is actually in outer space right now on the Voyager, on something called the Golden Record, which is supposed to be a record of humanity's cultural achievements and sounds from Earth. And her singing of this aria was so exceptional that they decided to put it on the Golden Record. So right now, for all we know, some alien life form could be enjoying Mozart's Der Hölle Rache. But Etta Moza was actually famous for singing this particular role because her voice was incredibly colorful and quite weighty, and so people were surprised that she had the speed and facility and dexterity to sing these runs with precision. She also did an incredible job of using colors that in her voice make the queen sound evil and angry, which also was not typical for people who sung this role before her. Then we come to Diana Damrau, who gained her fame by singing this role at the Royal Opera House in Covent Garden in London at the beginning of the 2000s, and whose portrayal you might be familiar with. She actually is the person who was maybe the first to really truly synthesize acting and vocalism so that it was completely seamless. And if you look her up, you can see her doing it on YouTube, and you'll just be in awe. I still am in awe of it today, and I've seen it hundreds of times. So there are quite a few other notable singers who have interpreted this. It's basically standard fare if you're a lyric coloratura soprano. And so please be curious and check them out on YouTube as well, as I've listed all their names on the slide. But not only has this song by Mozart been famous for its interpreters, but it's also become a complete marketing gimmick. It's been used in things like Volvo commercials, Etsy commercials, Amazon Alexa. It's been used in movie scores and on radio and in all sorts of commercial jingles. So I'm hoping that once you listen to this aria today, you will recognize and think to yourself, where did I last hear that? I'm sure you've heard it somewhere. Okay, here it is. Thank you. We've come, sadly, to the final piece on today's program, and it's from Lucia di Lammermoor, Donizetti's opera written in 1835 and premiered at the Teatro San Carlo in Naples, Italy. Right from the beginning, it was one of Donizetti's most beloved works of his tragic operas, and it was quite popular because it allowed for the soprano who was playing Lucia to show off her vocal pyrotechnics. However, because of that, it became known kind of as a showpiece, and singers began singing it almost as they would vocalises, and they didn't give much thought to the dramatic interpretation of the character. So after a while, it kind of fell out of favor because audiences were getting bored with it. But that all changed when Maria Callas came along, and in 1952, the then quite unknown Maria Callas was singing this role along with five other completely disparate roles at the Opera Nacional in Mexico City, Mexico, and there were critics there from all over the world and one from New York City. And when she sang her Lucia, especially these two arias, Regnava and then the Mad Scene aria, which we'll be hearing now, she was like a caged animal that was just let loose. She was just all over the place, and she was dramatic, and she was incredibly theatrical, and just living the role. She was playing it completely truthfully, and the critics had never seen anything like this before, especially in this opera, because it was known for all of this incredible vocal juggling and technical maneuvering. And Maria Callas not only did this crazy, amazing acting, but she also managed to combine that with the vocalism that was required of Donizetti really precisely and beautifully. And that just made people go absolutely wild for her. And so it was that in 1955, when she was singing this role with the La Scala Opera Company on tour in Berlin, Herbert von Karajan was conducting, and he was incredibly bowled over by her portrayal of this role, which led to her singing it in 1956 at the Metropolitan Opera. And that particular performance was broadcast live as one of the Met radio broadcasts. And those had run for many, many decades. And just recently, last December, the Met put out a survey to ask the audience which of its Met radio broadcasts were its favorite, which particular single one. And do you know what they ended up voting? This, 1956 Maria Callas in Donizetti's Lucia di Lammermoor. So she must have been doing something right, because even still, people are going crazy over her interpretation. So if you haven't heard that yet, take a listen to it. It's on the internet, you can look it up. The next interpreter that I want to mention is one of my absolute favorite singers of all time, who is in my Fach, who sings my voice part. And her name is Joan Sutherland. And she came to this role in 1959 when she premiered it at Covent Garden. She had also a voice that was quite sizable. So like Etta Moser, people thought maybe she was more suited for Wagnerian repertoire or something a little bit more substantial in weight. Yet, her husband, Richard Bonning, the conductor, realized correctly that she had the facility to do these roles and that her voice and the color of her voice flying all over the place and singing high and low and fast and slow would be so fascinating and scintillating that they absolutely had to try it. And so she premiered it to great acclaim at Covent Garden in 1959, and it's one of her most often and famous roles in general in her entire repertory. And indeed, which I thought was completely crazy, was still in 1982 when she was 56 years old, so nearing the end of her professional singing, she still sang this role at the Met, and she received a 12-minute standing ovation, which is something completely unheard of nowadays, right? There, of course, are many other notable interpreters that I've listed on the slide that you should take a look at, but those two are absolutely essential to familiarize yourself with, so please take a chance when you do to listen to them. All right, here's today's final piece. We do hope very much that you enjoy it. It is Lucia's Mad Scene.
Thank you. Love you. Thank you. afternoon. I'm Jeff Reed, Executive Director here at Community Music School. And I thank you for joining us today for the second part of Women in Music. I also thank our outstanding faculty members, Dr. Sue Waho and Julia Walsh, for presenting this fine program today. This program is part of our mission, which is to provide the inspiration and opportunity for anyone in our diverse community to achieve excellence in music education and appreciate the transformative power of music. With that, I again thank you for joining us and invite you to tune in once again April 21st for part 3 of Women in Music.